And let's start by talking about the Ministry of Encouragement. 1992, I went to a seminar by Selwyn Hughes, and he showed the difference between encouragement, exhortation, and enlightenment that Jesus used on the road to Emmaus. And this has become the very focus, and how this ministry has grown and followed the steps that Jesus took. So the first thing Jesus did with those two disciples on the road to Emmaus was to encourage them. And I want to tell you what encouragement is and what it isn't. It is not giving someone a Bible text. Because that's exhortation. In fact, they were so stringent on this that you couldn't attend the day on exhortation unless you had already been there on the day, on the previous day, where they taught on encouragement. In other words, they wouldn't allow you to use the scriptures until you'd learn how to earn the right to speak into someone's life at that level. So let me just tell you what encouragement is. I've got a few definitions here. Encouragement is the expression we use, either verbally or non-verbally, in helping a person to cope with or overcome a difficult time in their life and experience. And that really is encouragement. If you go straight to exhortation, it has a distinct possibility of being Bible bashing, which we're not really into. Now, another definition. One important verbal way of implementing the ministry of encouragement is to be skillful in the use of active listening. And active listening is really leaning in and listening to the person and not giving your own opinions or anything like that. You just want them to download, because the ministry of encouragement is like being a stretcher bearer. And that's one definition, Michael Slater. It's also allowing the client to, or the person, to empty the bottle, just pour it all out, or perhaps just sit with them silently, which is a ministry of presence, but also the ministry of encouragement. The client is to be the primary storyteller. The prayer minister is to be their companion on the journey. And why? Because people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And even Jesus earned the right to speak into those two disciples who were totally and utterly gutted on the road to Emmaus. They put all their eggs in one basket, and that was, and so they should have. But to see Jesus on that cross left them gutted and grief like you couldn't imagine. And Jesus went up to them and said, "Hey, you know, what's wrong? What are you talking about?" And he got them to pour it out in such a way that he earned the right, Almighty God earned the right to speak into their lives. And he did. He then started with Moses and all the prophets, and he chose that scripture from the Bible, because that disciple needed it. And he chose that scripture from the Bible because that disciple needed it. And he tailor-made each scripture to address a difficulty and a problem that that disciple had. And then right at the end of the day, while they're having dinner with him, their eyes were opened and they were enlightened. So they're the three big E's. Encouragement, exhortation, and enlightenment. Well, now, what happens when that person has poured out their story? To the best of my knowledge, what happens is people then say, "Well, now, let's pray. You've mentioned 385 things in the last hour. Let's just pray, Lord, bless this person and work it all out for them." And I'm sure the Lord will do whatever he can to do that. But once they have been encouraged by sharing their story, we need to know what event God wants to deal with first. So instead of just giving a general prayer, let's say this. And I've got the words on the new files that I'll send to you. In everyone's life, there is a hallway with rooms up and down the hallway. There is also a basement somewhere down there in the valley, but we'll come to that later. What room would you like to have cleared out first? And that's the circuit breaker. You've just told me all of these facts and figures. You've told me your life story just about. Okay. Well, in everyone's life, there's a hallway with rooms up and down the hallway. It's best to go vertical than horizontal when you do that. There is also a basement somewhere down there in the valley, but we'll come to that later. What room would you like to have cleared out first? And that must be memorized as a circuit breaker to everything they have just said, because A, I'm a guy, so I can only deal with one thing at a time. Stereotypically anyway. And we want to do a thorough work. In Jeremiah, as I said, it talks about they offer superficial treatment for my people's mortal wound. And that sentiment and thought is repeated not only in Jeremiah 8, chapter 11, it's also stated in Jeremiah 6, verse 14. And so we don't want to deal superficially with the wounds. We want to deal properly with them. Now, if they have no idea where they would like to start, and many don't, well, you can give them a hint. Well, perhaps we could start at the beginning of your life and work forwards to the end of your life, or start at this end of your life and work backwards. Or a third option is to actually deal with the traumas and events in the middle that are important to you. I mean, you've been talking about one of your parents for the last half hour. Does that sound like a good room we need to go to? And that's when, if they don't know, you make an anointed wise call or choice. But also the Lord can reveal to the person the issue. Many times I haven't known where to start. And I said, Lord, would you please reveal to this person what issue you would like them to deal with first? And something way out of the blue will surface, because that's where the Lord wants to start. So if the greater the person's giftings in hearing from the Lord, the better. Now, there's different terminology I use. And when I talk about in everyone's life, there's a hallway, well, I'm kind of using terminology to describe a human being made in the image of God as a house with a hallway with rooms up and down. But the Bible also refers to people as the body as being a temple, a tabernacle, which is a very fancy word for a tent, a body. And not only are there rooms up and down the hallway, but there's this interesting aspect that some of those rooms, not all of them, some of those rooms actually have labyrinths attached to them. Now, the difference between a labyrinth and a maze, mazes can have many exits and entrances, but a labyrinth only has one entrance, which also becomes the exit. And it's very interesting, the things that will go down those labyrinths to hide and to make sure they're not discovered. But we'll deal with that later. Now, the thing about this kind of ministry, this prayer ministry, is that there are many prayers that I have prayed over and over and over again. In church, we say the sinner's prayer, and it's repeated over and over again, and it never loses its importance. So there's one of these 12 plus prayers that I think I would have prayed, and I did a rough estimation the other day, approximately 10,000 times in the last couple of decades. That's a lot of saying it. And yet each time I say it, the Lord just moves powerfully. He ministers to that person, and the end result is whatever they came in for, they find that that is just slowly drifting off their radar. Okay, as they, yeah, they may have to spend a couple of days processing it and dealing with it, but as one lady said today, when she went back to see her parents, there just wasn't that animosity towards them that there used to be, and she could talk to them quite as a friend to friend. So, the first of these 12 prayers is the one which will reveal aspects of baggage, perhaps abusers, etc., that need to go to the cross, or even aspects of a loved one that may or may not have hurt them in some way. And so, here's what happens. We need a bridge between being a stretcher bearer and having them pour it all out, because you can't fit any more information into a bottle that's full. The bottle has to be emptied, then you can refill it. And the bridge, or the segue between them pouring out the bottle and going into prayer, is something like this. Well, you know, after what you've told me, let's ask God what he would like to do with those events. But before I pray, let me tell you, there are three basic ways God reveals things to people. Now, that segue, that bridge, will then help them identify what may surface when I pray. Because, today, someone felt this great amount of heat over their head. They also felt two hands on their head. And that's just the norm. That's just the norm. So you've got to sensitize people, and the one you're talking with. Once they've emptied the bottle, they are able now to receive. So, look, let me tell you three basic ways God reveals things to people. Now, in your mind, obviously the Lord designed the mind and he can use it for his glory. So you may see pictures, thoughts, words, memories, events, circumstances, situations, or even a flood of memories. Now, they won't remember all that, but if one of those things surfaces, then you can say, not that I told you so, but you can say, see, I mentioned that God may use one of those in a way of surfacing the real problems. Then you can talk about emotions in the heart, in the affective domain of a human being. And I usually do this. If it sounds like I've said this before, I really have. Emotional wounds are just like physical wounds. I usually hold up my arm and say, now, if I had a cut on my arm, a deep cut, and I didn't look after it for 1 week, what would happen to that cut? I say, infected, festered, germified. Okay, well, what happens if I didn't look after it for 3 months? Possibly drop off. Many people don't know what gangrene is. I'll have to explain it to them. And then I also have to explain sometimes septicemia and things like that, which go along with the flesh rotting. Anyway, they know it's going to rot. So I say, okay, well, emotional wounds are just like physical wounds. And the hurt and pain may generate, and here's the list, resentment, anger, unforgiveness, and then go rottenly gangrenous into bitterness, rage, hatred, and revenge. So they've got, and that may trigger stuff already. Then I say, well, there's a third way that the Lord can reveal things. That's through bodily feelings. And someone may get nausea, butterflies. And by the way, it's always good, once they've emptied the bottle, once they've shared what they want to share, to check if there are butterflies. Now, the problem is, yes, there will be anxiety and nerves and a whole lot of other things naturally generated, but there can also be butterflies which are supernatural. And it's demons, in other words. And it's always good to get rid of those before you start taking them on the journey of healing, room by room, in order that they can calm down and just be a little bit more with it, a little bit more relaxed. And we'll come to the prayer that I've done almost 10,000 times that can do all of that. As I said, there may be nausea in the gut, butterflies, chest restrictions, chest pains, palpitations of the heart, throat restrictions, pains in the neck, bands around the head, headaches, and assorted pains and bodily pains and feelings. And believe it or not, God can use all of that to symbolize and to reveal to someone what they need to give back to him at the feet of Jesus 2,000 years ago. Yeah, it's an incredible process. Today, on Monday, we had someone who was going hot, cold, hot, cold, hot, cold, hot, cold inside. And as fast as that, today someone with the enemy actually swirling around inside and jumping all over the place. And and choking them at the same time. So you've got to check for these things. And when you pray and ask the Lord to reveal what they need to give to him at the feet of Jesus, all of these stuff will and can and usually does surface. So you've actually got to sensitize them to the range of things that can happen so that when you start dealing with it, they'll know that you're not making this up. Many people, you know, if we get rid of the butterflies before we start bedding them, they're usually stunned and amazed when they feel like butterflies just leaving their life. A couple of days ago, one guy felt something sink down and go out through his feet. Well, this is just in the last week. And I could go on for months and years with similar stories. But here's the prayer, number one, that is good for surfacing what needs to be got rid of in the rooms. Excuse me. Now, when I'm praying, I like to start with glorifying God for my sake. Because when I start glorifying the Lord, it helps me focus on him rather than the problem. Because I know he's the only one that can deal with this, so I focus on him. And I usually say something like, gracious, tender-hearted Father, in the name of your wonderful Son, Jesus, and through the awesome ministry of the Holy Spirit. Then we get down to work. I ask you, Lord, to reveal to Bill, Mary, through thoughts, emotions, or bodily feelings, what they need to know or what they need to give to you at the feet of Jesus on the cross over 2,000 years ago. Now, that's the request. I ask you, Lord, to reveal. I use the word reveal, not talk, not show. Now, there was one person today who was very auditory in his hearing from the Lord. But some people are very visual in their hearing from the Lord. Other people feel things. So it depends how God designs them, how he's going to use what he's designed in them to reveal things that they need to know. So I ask you, Lord, to reveal to Bill, Mary, through thoughts, emotions, bodily feelings, what they need to know or what they need to give to you. It's a two-part request. What they need to know or what they need to give to you. Because sometimes they don't need to give things to him. They just need to know something. And where? At the feet of Jesus on the cross over 2,000 years ago. Now, I use the word over 2,000 years ago because the enemy is such legal eagles that if I said 2,000 years ago, they'd say, no, it's not 2,003 years ago. So I've just said, okay, over 2,000 years ago, or just put them at the feet of Jesus on the cross there. And that way I get around all the legal eagles. And here I go back to God. Because, Father, I'm asking in Jesus' name. And Jesus said, I'm going back to the Father. And whatever you ask in my name, he's going to do it. You know, and that's obviously if it's in according to his will. But I'm going to, because Father, I'm asking in Jesus' name and through the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's where all those thoughts, emotions, and physical feelings start to rise. The hands on that, two hands on that guy's head today. Ah, that and the heat. And cold, the cold I'm happy with. That's nearly always demons. Always demons. But the heat, sometimes the heat is the warmth of God's love. Other times it's just a demon making them feel hot. And discerning between one and the other is really a big job. Those two hands on the head, I didn't know if that was the Lord or the enemy. And hopefully before session's out today, I'll give you a prayer that we used to sort that out. Okay. Now, when it says to put at the feet of Jesus 2,000 years ago that they need to give to you, what that means is, what they need to get rid of, push, because the Bible says, cast all your burdens upon him because he cares for you, lovingly and sacredly release. If it's a loved one that's passed and they're grieving terribly, well, sometimes they're too red raw to do it within a short space of time, but after a while they know that they've got to release that person, their loved one, because if they don't, they will not be able to get on with their life and progress. So for them, I say, you know, lovingly and sacredly release at the feet of Jesus. Give your loved one as a beautiful Christmas present to the one who gave that person to you. And I use this many, many times. If they're made out of atoms, well, they belong to the one who created the atoms. And there's only one person I know that created the atoms, and that's Jesus. So If anything's made out of atoms, Jesus says, mine, my property, I did it. If you're not made out of atoms, well, you are not here. Because he created every atom in the universe. And more than that, when God gives you a loved one, really and truly, they're only on loan to you. Unfortunately, some parents have really brutalized their kids and have betrayed God, betrayed the family, and everyone else, because they didn't do it according to God's will. But it's God's will that every parent nurture and look after the kids. If they don't, they have betrayed God. And I know there can be many times when there are problems. Some kids have autistic meltdowns, and I'm aware of that whole realm, and kids that are hurting and don't feel they belong. Well, they're like a person who's just gone out of orbit. The Bible says that God's love constrains me. Now, what that means is it stops me from going off the handle, stops me from punching a wall, because his love constrains me. It stops me. But there are kids now who don't have that constraining ability, because society has almost engineered, and I believe there's real reasons for that, have almost engineered to get rid of the God syndrome from the planet, so that the enemy can take over. And as people have been cut loose from Almighty God, their Savior, they have no constraining factor in their lives. Love is the only constraining factor that I know of. All right. So, in the notes I'll send you, I'm going to read out a whole lot of stuff that people over the years, over the decades, have experienced, and how the Lord surfaced stuff, revealed things to them. Oh, even today. One guy whose dad was a World War II veteran, World War I, they were shell-shocked. World War II, they had war neuroses, a much nicer name for the same horrible thing. Now we call it post-traumatic stress disorder, which is really even a much nicer name for a terrible affliction. Anyway, this guy, all he ever remembers his dad was drunk and used to bash them up. But today, Lord, would you please reveal to this person something that they either need to know or that they need to give to you? Or both, actually. Well, the Lord showed this guy, spoke a few words to this guy, literally spoke to this guy. Your father loved you. Well, I know that was God, because that man had never, ever thought of that factor in his whole life. God actually had to show it to him and speak to him about it before he even had a clue that his father loved him. Actually, that's happened twice in the last fortnight. God said the same thing to someone. And I said, you know, when God says something, you've got to tease it out a bit. Tease it out a bit, if I can use that terminology. Okay, mate. Have you ever thought of that your God, your dad loved you? Have you ever thought of that before? No, never. Okay. Is it the kind of thought you would have every 10 minutes? Never. Did I say those words to you? No, it wasn't you. Well, who does that leave? And the devil wouldn't want to say that to you because that brings healing. So I'll ask again, who do you think that who said those words? Now it's very interesting. That person said, oh, my dad did. Stop there. No, that doesn't happen. There's only one person that can do that, and that's God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So you have just been told by God that your father loved you, this brand new thought. How do you reckon that's going to affect you? And that's what I mean by teasing it out, okay? Just explore the possibilities of that great word given to that guy. Now I've got a whole list of those to sensitize you to the experiences that I go through week by week by week. He goes. There was a husband who didn't trust his wife, thought she was being as promiscuous as he used to be. And the Lord said to him, she said, I do at the altar. Now, tease that out. She said, I do at the altar. In other words, what she said back then, in spite of your vile domestic violence towards her, and in spite of your not trusting her that she's with other men, she said, I do at the altar, as if to say, and she hasn't changed her mind. Okay, so that's one. Next one. Oh, it was another husband who didn't trust his wife. And this time he saw a vision of him, excuse me, him and her standing at the altar. And she was much shorter than him. And she was looking up at him. And the Lord impressed on this guy that from this picture, can you see that you are her hero? Because she was just looking up at the guy. And he hasn't, he's pulled his head in and treating her like the hero. I say, okay, well, now, what does that mean? Tease it out. What does that mean? That means that you have to start acting like a hero and not a villain. You have to start behaving like the man she expects you to be. Teasing it out. Next. This person had a fear of being close to Jesus. Now, in the Bible, you read things like he has eyes of flame and a tongue, a sword comes out of his mouth like a tongue. And I have had one woman about 25 years ago who, when that was being done in the Bible study, ran out of the Bible study, came to me terrified that that was the kind of God she was worshiping. But you see, here's the thinking. God is that kind of fearful person to Satan, but he's not like that to us. To us, he is but a gentle lamb. As a lamb before its shearer is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. So So that wrong concept of Jesus has frightened people. But the Lord spoke to this person and said, something like, just trust me. And that, by the way, was a real big problem in her life. All right, next. This person, quite shocked, she saw a picture of her dad smiling. She had never seen a vision or a picture, never actually seen him smile, but the Lord showed him smile. And that brought a great deal of comfort and healing. But she still had to give that smiling down to the Lord, because what I tell people is, don't let the good be a thief of the best. Okay, you've now got a smiling dad. That's pretty good. You haven't had one all your life. You got one now. And by the way, this is actually how I talk. So how about giving this smiling dad, this good dad, to the Lord? Because don't let the good be a thief of the best. Because we want him to go, and we want the best dad not only on this planet, but in the entire universe. And I've said that a thousand times. Best dad not only on this planet, but in the entire universe. Because when I say the best mum, not only on this planet, now I have to use it with that, because many people come up with, well, who's the best mum in the universe? Mary? Well, she was good, and the Lord thought she was good enough to bear God's son, so she must have had a lot going for her. But. Did you know that one day Jesus' mother Mary, and she's not the mother of God, she's the mother of Jesus. God doesn't have a mother. That Jesus was talking to the scribes and Pharisees in this massive crowd, and mum and her brother and Jesus' siblings and brothers were outside, and they wanted to take him away. They wanted to take him and put him away somewhere quiet, in a happy farm, perhaps, where he would do no damage, where they wouldn't be continually embarrassed by what he was saying and doing. I mean, his first ministry in his home church, they tried to kill him. His first sermon in his home church. They marched him to the top of the hill and were going to push him over and kill him. Well, you can imagine Mary and Jesus' brothers, and I think he had two sisters, all being totally embarrassed at Jesus, and they wanted to take him away. But Jesus said, who is my mother and my brethren? Those who do the will of God are my mother and brethren. So Mary and his siblings really blotted their copybooks at that time, but they did have them fixed up later on. All right, next. We've done four of about 30. Here you go. But I just want to sensitize you to the approach that I use. All right, this woman saw two rooms, one with friends in and one with her drinking mates in. And she had to give one of those to the feet of Jesus at the cross. Fortunately, she made the right decision. Next, there's this woman who had, oh, sorry, no, this was God. He had a bag full of sexual partners. And the Lord got him to take that bag and put that at the cross. When praying for someone who's addicted to pornography, they saw the house and the room where it started. Now, why will the Lord not, NOT, Unless it's for an absolutely enormous reason. Show pornography to a person. Well, basically, because he is not a pornographer. That is the bottom line. He's not a pornographer. Some examples are when I prayed for the Lord to show people about what's in that room with pornography on the door, there's been a range of things that happened. One person saw a big book. The book was closed, and they had to give the book to the Lord. Others were, where are we? Others had seen the pictures flash so fast that they could not concentrate or fix on one in any one photo, but they knew it was about pornography. All right. So, oh, by the way, one of the funniest ones was the Lord showed this guy God the Father and God the Son in hazmat suits, helmets, white gloves, white shoes, boots, white suit with oxygen tanks and shovels in their hand, because God considers pornography to be toxic waste. And so that these two beings with hazmat suits on went into the room to clean out the hazmat suits. I hope you're getting the idea of the range of things. A throbbing in the head, easily removed. Many people feel lightheaded, and that's good because that usually means a lot of baggage has been removed. If someone has a lot of luggage and they let it down, they usually feel a lot lighter. Well, so it is. Oh, here goes. This woman saw a picture of an inverted tornado, and that symbolized her boyfriend. She would be grossly unwise if she pursues that relationship. Another person saw something go inside this beautiful mansion. It was an entity. It went into the doorway and into the room and then screamed. Well, that was a demon that Jesus had to get rid of. And you can read quite a few of the others. A sense, here's what something that surfaced, a sense that I'll have to do this all on my own. So Jesus showed them a picture of Jesus holding my hand, knowing that no, you don't have to do it alone. Dad worked away in mining, and very sad when he left, because he left quite often, FIFO type things. And God showed her the word dad in gold lettering. Oh, here's an interesting one. This person was bullied at school. So the Lord showed that person and revealed to him a reminder that at her confirmation, I think it was in the Church of England, she was like a Joan of Arc, someone very strong, very brave, and she wasn't what these bullies said about her. She was a Joan of Arc. All right. This person had alcohol, marijuana, and pornography problems. And so the Lord showed this person a ship with contraband cargo of alcoholism, marijuana, and pornography on it, and the ship was sailing away, etc. And when we come to children who have been aborted, miscarried, stillborn, or cot deaths, We'll talk about some of the incredible things that happened there. Now, it's 8:19, and I think you may have had enough of me by now. I think I might just close it off at this, and next time, in a fortnight's time, start off with the prayer of divorcing or breaking off or cutting off or separating that abuser event from the person's life. And we'll continue there next time. Thank you so much for listening and helping me produce this in order to raise up people who have got the heart for it and want to see these incredible things that God does in people's lives. It's truly amazing.